Welcome back to SOMO TV. I'm Dalton Weaver. This is my psychic partner in crime, Richard Scott. Brought you back to the next episode. For today, I want to introduce Zim for her induction into the Hall of Fame. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. So my question is, since besides law enforcement that got you accomplished, what other accomplishments that do you think that got you into the Hall of Fame?
I think it would just have to be the work I've done for many years with Special Olympics Missouri. I've enjoyed working with Special Olympics and the staff and the coaches and especially the athletes. So just working with the athletes has been the best.
What is your favorite about Special Olympics?
Oh, I think it's because even in uniform, when we're supposed to be so serious and, you know, upholding law and everything like that, we can have a lot of fun. And it was just being with the athletes and hanging out at different events or awarding medals or whatever it is. Whatever fundraising event we were at, we could just have fun. And that's the best.
What was going through your mind whenever you when you heard that you got, when you heard you were going to get inducted into the Hall of Fame?
I didn't believe it. They surprised me after a meeting for our state games that's coming up in Springfield, and they surprised me after the meeting, and they had everyone assembled in a room, and I still didn't understand why there was a bunch of people from that had driven down from Kansas City and from Columbia and from Jeff City. I didn't know why they were there, and it was just interesting. I didn't even realize what was going on until Jeannie Bylan actually read the words, and that's why I was very surprised and very shocked.
What got you into Special Olympics?
Actually, when I became an officer in the early 1990s, a long time ago, I knew that law enforcement supported Special Olympics worldwide. And the chief at the time basically said, hey, you need to start getting involved. And so I participated in some of the 5Ks and some of the events, but then he slowly dragged me into it. And Chief Randy Bames said, hey, how about you coordinate this event for our department? Then how about you help with the regional games? Hey, how about helping with the state games? And just on and on, and just more and more responsibilities and fundraising and efforts with our department at the time. And that's what really got me hooked.
Why is Special Olympics your favorite thing?
I think it's because the athletes that I work with and have over the years and I've known, I don't look at them as having disabilities. I think they have different abilities. Because a lot of the athletes can do things I can't. And I'm always amazed and in awe of people who can do things that I can't. And I just enjoy working with the athletes and seeing their positive energy just coming off constantly. Anything that they're doing, and it's just wonderful to see. That's one of my favorites.
My next question I would like to ask you, what is your favorite Special Olympic memory?
Oh, my gosh.
And why?
I probably have a couple.
Okay.
And on here, it would probably have to be the first time that I was asked to carry the torch at the state games, and I was very excited. It was very thrilling for me. After many years of hard work, that was a thrill. And then the second would have to be when I was asked to be the delegate to go to the World Summer Games in Greece. And it was just so thrilling for me and very emotional to meet athletes from around the world and to know that it was just one big happy family and to get to run in 65 different cities for 3 weeks and meet so many cool people that are associated with Special Olympics around the world, and that had to be one of the best for me.
I heard that you were on Gladiators. How was that?
That was a long time ago. That was when I was really young and foolish. That was before my law enforcement career, and I decided to go on the show. And I ended up in the hospital. Broken. Yeah, it was not funny at the time. Broken in several pieces. Broke my foot in 3 pieces. Dislocated my jaw. Had hip pointers. Had a sprained ankle. It was kind of a mess. But it was a lot of fun at the time. So I had a blast. It was fun to try to go against the big women out there.
I want to thank you for being here.
Thank you.
My name is Richard Scott. This is Dalton Weaver, and we'll be right back.
Athlete Leadership Programs, or ALPS as it's commonly referred to, is a new program here in Missouri. What we've done in the last year since 2015 on is really start to give our athletes the proper training that they require to become leaders within their teams and within their communities. So ALPS is the perfect vehicle to get them more involved in the Special Olympics movement. And just one other way that Special Olympics is so much more than just sports for a lot of our athletes. It's about giving them the proper leadership training that they're interested in a variety of different ways.
As progressive as Special Olympics was to sports and physical education and health for people with intellectual disabilities was, many years ago, I think ALPS is just as progressive. You know, here are these people that have been disenfranchised and they are not given a lot of options and choice in their own life. They're told what to do a lot. And now we are going to empower them to really take on their own organization. At the heart of it, it is education. And it's great to see Special Olympics as a sport organization jump into this idea of, you know, we want to empower athletes to be leaders, but we also want to teach them to be leaders. And I think it's fantastic looking at all the different programming that we have available to athletes and the Leadership for Life programs, where athletes are really learning skills that benefit them and their employment ability to be independent. That's really what I want to see, and I think that's unique. Nobody else is doing that.
Being a leader is helping other athletes and showing other parents and helping other coaches. I like raising money to help other participate in Special Olympics. My major is to be a public speaker to speak to other businesses to get involved with Special Olympics.
Each class does have a homework or practicum component along with it, so it's not just they attend the class, check the box, and kind of move on to the next class or next university. In order for this program to really be successful and properly train our athlete leaders, then they need to have something that proves they actually learned something in the class.
I would really like, in the future, you know, education to look at this and say, wow, you know, these individuals are learning skills, gaining confidence in a way that hasn't happened anywhere else, and using that as a model to develop growth in these individuals, because it's there, that potential is there. It's just getting people in place that can help develop it.
I want to get involved with ALPS, you know, to advance myself, be able to learn more about what I can do to help others and to be able to get back to the community and stuff for what they have done for us. I think that as we grow, I think that we'll give other athletes a chance to become coaches, to become, you know, public speakers, and to be able to grow and learn more other than just sports.
Throughout this whole ALPS University process, our athlete leaders are never alone. They have mentors who are with them every step of the way. It could be somebody that they already know, like a coach or unified partner or a sibling, or it could be a new Special Olympics Missouri volunteer. But the idea is that the mentors are there not to do the work for them, but to kind of push them when our athlete leaders need a little push and kind of guide them along if they need help.
With Becca, I've seen at the very beginning, she was a lot more timid and it was hard to get information, whereas now she's riding so much better. It's not taking nearly the amount of time because she's been improving through this university.
I've had the pleasure of working with an athlete leader, Daxton Miller, for the past year. And in that year, I have witnessed tremendous growth in areas specifically involving his confidence. I am truly blessed to be in a position where I can coach him through some really difficult skills to learn, and in the year I've witnessed him grow in a tremendous way, especially with his independence.
I want the athletes to realize that they can lead their own lives, make choices, and determine their own outcomes. I want the mentors to see these individuals with intellectual disabilities and realize that they don't have to be coddled, they don't have to be held to a lower standard, maybe a different standard, but they can still achieve, they can still learn to be leaders. I hope that people who stick around long enough and see ALPS become what I know it can be, really get a new appreciation for people with intellectual disabilities, and they realize that there is so much untapped potential, and that we will stop making assumptions and choices for these individuals and allow them to make choices on their own and grow into what they want to be, not what we want them to be.
This is my very first college. Come join ALPS, it's kind of fun.
This is SOMO TV. My name is Richard Scott. I'm here with Carol for Healthy Athletes. What is Healthy Athletes?
Healthy Athletes is a program that we offer for our athletes. They get to come to Healthy Athletes at our state games. They go through 7 screenings when we have them all available. But there's screenings for your eyes. We have it. Opening eyes, special smiles, healthy hearing, fit feet, health promotions, MedFest, where you can get your physicals, and then we have Fun Fitness.
How long have you done Healthy Athletes?
I've only been involved with Special Olympics for 1.5 years. So in that 1.5 years, I've been busy trying to build Healthy Athletes so we can have a big program for all our athletes.
What is your long-term goal for Healthy Athletes?
Well, it's important for Healthy Athletes for our athletes to be able to get screenings, because a lot of athletes, because of their disability or transportation or finances, don't get to see a doctor on a regular basis. So it's my goal that we get all of our athletes to participate in Healthy Athletes. And then our long-term goal is we have to get referrals for the athletes, so once they get their screenings, they're able to find a doctor and get their problems fixed, their eyes, ears, whatever the problem is. So we've got to recruit doctors to be involved with our program.
How does Healthy Athletes help athletes?
Well, they will help the athletes get their screenings so they see a doctor on a regular basis, and it gets them familiar with doctors, so down the road they'll be able to find their own doctor and be comfortable with them.
I'm an athlete leader. How does Healthy Athletes fit in ALPS?
Into the ALPS program, this is something new that we're working on. We are going to design a course for health to where the athletes will learn more about it, and they'll know the importance of the health program for their own life, and eventually they can learn, and then hopefully maybe down the road they can help teach the course, but we want them to learn the importance of health.
I heard that you were in Washington, D.C. Can you tell me about it?
Sure. I had the privilege of traveling to Washington, D.C. with Alan Tobin, fellow athlete, and we went to learn more on Healthy Athletes, and it was just amazing to see the athletes. We had approximately 12 athletes there that were speaking up and being advocates for their own health, for Healthy Athletes. And it was amazing to see them talk and share their experiences and the future what ifs, you know, how they would handle things. We learned more about the Healthy Athletes program, how it will benefit the athletes, and we listened to the athletes to see what they wanted in the program and how it's going to benefit them in the future.
Well, thank you.
Well, thank you. It was nice meeting you, and thank you so much.
Yep. My name is Richard Scott. Thank you for watching, and we'll be right back.
Plunge like there's no manana to support Special Olympics Missouri athletes. Come out of your winter siesta and be a part of our fiesta at your choice of 13 frigid bodies of water this January, February, and March. Sponsored by your local law enforcement, proceeds support 15,000 children and adults with intellectual disabilities in year-round sports training and competition throughout the Show Me State. To find out how you can get involved, visit somo.org/plunge. So get your family and friends together and take the plunge to make a difference in an athlete's life today.
The John Michael Letz Award was established in December 1994 for the purpose of recognizing an individual whose unselfish efforts and contributions are directly responsible for the success of the law enforcement torch run for Special Olympics Missouri. It is our Unsung Hero Award. The Torch Run Committee elected to name this award after Mike because of his longtime efforts while serving on the St. Louis Metropolitan Police Department and who died from cancer in 1995. The St. Louis Trivia Night fundraiser was his creation, and it continues still today.
John Michael Letz was my friend. And John Michael Letz is the first guy who said, you know what we ought to do? We should fundraise. We need to do the Trivia Night. He's the one who taught us to raise money. He taught us that this was going to be a year-round endeavor, not just 1 month a year. We were going to fundraise all year round so that we could raise the amount of money that we do. Now, we don't even have to talk about fundraising around the calendar. What we talk about is what we're going to do next. And it's all the growth from all the good people that have been involved in law enforcement and the torch run. And we're blessed to have everybody.
The first recipient of this award was Colonel Ralph Beeley, who was instrumental in starting Missouri's torch run 30 years ago. I was the recipient last year, and it was truly an honor, truly an honor. The criteria for recipients include responsible for significant fundraising results, participates in year-round support, exemplifies the Special Olympics mission, someone who is a visionary for the torch run, someone whose source of motivation comes from helping the athletes, and who shows sustained commitment over a period of time. We have many who are torch run enthusiasts, no doubt. Most we don't know. We don't know them because they don't do it for the recognition. And that's why they are deserving of the Letz Award. They are usually in the background, working to make sure more is done. About this year's recipient, involved in the torch run for 7 years, is involved in fundraising in both local and statewide fundraising events, is the agency coordinator for their department, which has raised over $632,000, astounding, in the last 7 years alone. Volunteers to hand out medals at both local and state events. Volunteers at SOMO state events as an event manager. Organizes a torch run in conjunction with local school field day events. Serves on the local Polar Plunge Committee and has been instrumental in growing this event to where it is today. Serves as a unified partner and athlete mentor. In the words of the nominator, this recipient always has a positive outlook and is always setting goals for not only the law enforcement officers, but the athletes as well. This recipient is one of the most positive officers I have had the pleasure of working with. It is my honor to present this award to a person who makes a big difference to her agency and her region, to the LETR family, and to SOMO's athletes. The 2016 Letz Unsung Hero Award goes to Officer Amanda Gino, Lee Summit PD.
Thank you.
Truly, truly very deserving. She is apparently is very bashful and shy and quiet.
No, she's not.
Thank you. Truly an honor.
Welcome back to SOMO TV. My name is Dalton Weaver. I'm introducing Susan Shaffer, competition director.
How are you?
Welcome. I got some questions if you don't mind me asking.
Sure.
My first question I want to ask you, what is the indoor games?
Well, our indoor games is our competition for state basketball and state bowling that we have each year at Fort Leonard Wood and Waynesville, and then we house in St. Roberts. We'll start on Friday with bowling, then Saturday we have bowling and basketball, and then on Sunday we go back to just bowling. So we're busy weekend, full of lots of activities to go on during, besides basketball, of course the opening ceremonies, and then healthy athletes and Victory Village. So lots going on during that time.
Pretty excited. I had really good experience last year playing basketball and bowling. My question is, difference from last year, what's going to be better this year?
Well, we'll be once again back in for opening ceremony, back inside. We just, with weather and stuff, that'll be back inside, and lots of soldiers back out for opening ceremony, which is always exciting to have the soldiers a part of the event. We're changing up a little bit of some scheduling, timing-wise for the event, make it, you may get to sleep in a little bit more than usual. Our barracks are a little different in the barracks than was last year. We have some of the new ones and some of the older ones. Adding on a different school to add more teams. So we'll see what the change is. And sometimes we leave surprises for you guys, too.
Definitely going to be an excitement. My next question is, I heard the indoor games are a qualifier for the U.S. Games for Special Olympics.
They are. We got bowling slots and a basketball team, unified basketball team for the USA in 2018 in Seattle. The athletes who participate and are interested in going have to get a gold medal to qualify. So we have both athletes and unified partners in for bowling. And then, of course, our basketball team is a unified. And they must get a gold in basketball, and they must be nominated as a team. Are you interested in going?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Okay. Well, that's it for the day. Thank you, Shaffer.